The patriarch had the exam today.
The exam?
Talking about media.
Oh, yeah.
Well, your lessons are well, eh?
Yeah, I explained.
Is that the main exam?
Yeah, it's one of two.
Yeah, we've got another one next week.
Yeah, it's one of two for the fine media. We've got another one next week.
Oh, look, Vin's it.
Hey, Vin! Hey! Hello, it's gonna be up to you.
I'm like, is a new decent.
Oh, yeah. I don't just want to
No, no, no.
And also about the exam, because Mark is set up for the exam. These are all on your course document, but I just repeat for you. It doesn't just apply to this unit that runs every unit. If a unit assessment has two elements like this one, then you must pass both elements. This unit, for example, has an exam element and a coursework element. Right? The coursework you've already done, it was the last. You need to pass both elements in order to pass. The pass mark is 40%. And the pass mark is made up of, is an aggregate, remember, it's an aggregate of the exam and the course, depending on the proportion. For this exam, it's 60%. Sorry, for this unit, it's 60% exam and 40% course. Yes? And as I said, the pass mark of it, so you must get it, you must get at least 40% in the aggregate. But if you've got, once you have the 40%, then the pass mark for the individual elements is only 36. Do you understand that? So in other words, if, for example, you get 36% of the coursework, and I don't know, perhaps 44% or 50% in the exam, then the aggregate is worked out. And as long as the aggregate is over 40%, then you have passed, although you've only got 36%. But it can't be less than 36%. Is that clear?
Yeah.
It is clear.
Yeah.
The units in which there's only one element, like for example in some units is only four, then you must get that 40%, because that is the aggregate. Alright? Okay, there's two more! Two more topics left, two very short topics left that I'm going to cover, and then after that, from next week, I'm going to teach you. The two topics left, as I said last week, recycling and then semiconductors. The very short basics of semiconductors. Let's start with recycling of materials. I know recycling is become a big issue now. It's very fashionable to recycle everything, etc. But you do need to have an appreciation of what is the effect of recycling, which materials are more effective, which materials are less effective, and exactly what this recycling is. I start with metals. Recycling of metals. Almost all metals, and you can't say this about plastics and ceramic, almost all metals can be recycled. In fact, all metals can be recycled. Some metals are, some alloys are a bit more difficult than others. But all metals virtually can be recycled. The common method that we've been working on, we generally use are these that are listed here. Well, it's listed, the steel, aluminium, copper alloys, and then also things like nickel, zinc alloys, magnesium alloys, and so on. We look at steel and aluminium and copper in a little bit more detail. Starting with steel. Remember, all metals, nearly all metals, except for exceptions like gold, as I've always said, all metals are produced from their oxides. So in nature, they're combined with something, with other elements. So the first thing we need to do is separate them from that combination, to free them. And that thing itself takes a lot of energy, both money and energy. Generally speaking, when you recycle a metal, then that separation, in other words, freeing it from the oxide, is not involved. So you actually saved on one of the major steps. How do you make steel? What is steel is made from iron, yes, mainly. And how do we find iron? What is iron? Iron is in the form of iron ore, which is what? Iron oxide. Yeah. Iron oxide. The first thing we have to do is free iron from oxygen to free. And that takes energy. We either need to use gas, coal, or occasionally electricity, but in every case, as well as using these natural resources, you also have to heat it in other words, energy. Whereas when you recycle something that has already been shaped into something, all you really need to do is remelt it. Okay, you need to do a little bit of purification, but it's very different to when you have to separate it from its oxide. Steel in particular is very important, is very valuable. Recycling of steel is very valuable for two reasons. A, it's relatively easy to recycle it, and two, there are lots and lots of steel components. And another thing is steel, because most steel are magnetic, they're very easy to separate. One of the issues with recycling is actually picking materials off. With cast non-magnetic materials, you actually have to mechanically pick them off. With steel, because they're magnetic, you've probably seen it in films, huge magnets that pick parts of the car or whole of car off. So, steel is one of those materials that is relatively easy. Here, so some statistics are put here for you. I don't expect you to remember them by heart, but it's useful to have some appreciation. 400 million tons of metal is recycled every year. 400 million, that's a lot. Four and a half UK UK's the UK's recycling is £4.5 billion a year. £4.5 billion a year. Then there are the EU figures and global figures and so on. Thank you. For Steve, generally speaking, for Steve, you recycle by remelting the steel into our electric arc furnace. In other words, you use electricity to heat it up. Copper is used both in the primary processing and secondary processing. Primary processing is when you actually producing basically virgin copper when you for the first time. And lots of materials when you produce them even for the first time, you use a lot of scrap. In other words, steel scrap, copper scrap, copper alloy structures, etc. Aluminium is one of those very important materials because production of aluminium from scrap is only one way of producing aluminium, and that is through electrolysis. As I've said this lots of times before, from aluminium oxide, and the only way you can free aluminium from its oxide is using electricity. It's not like other methods where you can use chemical processes or from gas, like with steel, you use carbon. Or with copper, you use chemical processes. With aluminium, the only way to do it is using electricity. And that is both expensive and very, very energy. A lot of energy is used. Whereas once aluminium is made, when you recycle kinds of aluminium or any other aluminium, then you don't need to do the first process. All you need to do is just melt it. Aluminium. What is the melting point of aluminium? Roughly. Come on. Yes, exactly. To be exactly 660. So if you have scrap aluminium, all you need to do is to heat it to a temperature of 660. In practice, you heat it to about 700, then it will be over 700. But if you need to do it from scratch, from the sort of oxide state, from alumina, which is aluminium oxide, before you even do the electrolysis, you need to heat it to a temperature of about 1,950 or so. So a lot of energy. And then after that, you need to use electricity. In this table, and you need to have an appreciation, not necessarily know the exact value, but you need to have an appreciation of the relative importance or relative value of recycling all different materials. And you can see aluminium is the energy you save by recycling aluminium is 95%. So, copper is a lot because copper uses electricity as well, also. But they are all significant percentage. But these are the actual. The actual percentages of materials that are used by recycling. And so although with aluminium you do a lot of things, because in practice there's a lot to be done with aluminium, and lots more recycling of aluminium can be done. that isn't being done at the moment. It's only 39% of new metal is from recycled aluminum. One of the reasons is actually the difficulty in collecting, because it's not magnetic. The usual thing is problem with air pollution, water use, water pollution. All these are the things that are, you get this as a result of producing metal from scratch. With recycling use, you avoid a lot of these things, don't reduce a lot of
this.
It's with non-ferrous materials are things like aluminium, copper, zinc, etc. Everything other than steel. Everything other than steel. As you can see, 1 million tons of non-ferrous metals were recycled. 45% was aluminium, 31% copper, etc. Another important economic issue is UK. It's actually one of the biggest recycling countries. I think it's the fifth country in terms of recycling. For its size, it's very, very good. And it actually makes a lot of money out of it. Now the things about the typical products you can see here, the typical products that are being recycled. Cans is one of the largest products. Both aluminium cans and steel cans. Generally, packaging materials is recycled a lot. Cars, because as it says here, over 75% of cars are metal. Then things like batteries, etc., that have their own recycling. Elements of recycling like collection, weighing, sorting, etc. are important. We need to have an appreciation of that these things actually happen. Scrap metal is the term that's used for basically recycling metal. As I said, scrap metal is used both in production of sort of virgin metals and also in processing of secondary metal. The virgin ones are the ones that they said when you make steel, rush even from iron ore, always some you add some scrap. Some scrap steel. But also you can, in the secondary or purchase scrap, is because you use scrap, you melt it and change it into new shapes, different shapes. You also, every industry, both plastics and metal industry, especially metal industry, they have what they call home scrap, because for example, if you do rolling, if you do cutting, shearing, etc., there's always a lot of scrap. And that scrap is also very important to be used, to be recycled, as well as the scrap that you actually buy to use.
I don't know why you did that.
Went out, I can kill it. My friend and you can move that yard.
Okay.
No, I was like, sorry.
Really, the basic. I don't want to go into the popular way from the science, all the sorry information you need there, but it's there. Don't need to know these values by heart. I don't know all of them by heart, but you need to have an appreciation, as I said, of the general values and comparative importance of resourcing for different materials. Resourcing of aluminium, I've already said. Okay, now let's go to just a little bit of plastics. This now shows the proportions of the different sectors that use plastic and recycle plastic. Medical, mechanical, engineering, footwear, toys, etc. Various proportions of plastic use. Plastic is one of those things that is going up in use every year on year. And recycling of plastic is getting more and more developed. Some years ago, there were only certain types of plastic they could recycle. But now there's every year, there's more processes that are developed so that even more difficult plastics can be recycled now. Plastics are marked according to their type by these standards. You see, and generally put, they're given numbers. PET is 1, HDPE is 2, PVC is 3, etc. In Bournemouth, for example, I don't know whether they have passed the whole of Dorset, but in Bournemouth, for example, they can recycle 1, 2, and 3. They can't recycle the other one.
Sorry.
But as I said, in different places, that's a little bit more advanced. And these standards, these markings, will tell you what can be recycled and what can't be recycled. This is a useful marking both for identifying plastics. This 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and also for to find out what which one we can recycle, which one. 7 is the one that any other plastic is just. At the moment, it's classified under number 7. Again, lots more statistics. How much of your rubbish bin is, I don't know, paper, how much of it is soil, how much of it is kitchen, etc. It's all here if you're interested. Various statistics for plastics again here. There are some plastics that are called degradable ones, and those good people do degradable ones. You can leave them in nature, and they go, they disappear themselves. So they don't have to do much to them. When we talk about degradable anything, two things you need to remember. A, shouldn't be an excuse to just increase the amount of rubbish everywhere. People could just leave things and say, well, it's going to be disappear, so there's no point in putting it. And the other one is sometimes for materials to degrade, to disappear naturally, you need certain elements. You need, for example, oxygen. If there is no oxygen, that may not happen. If there is no water, that may not happen. So it's important to know under what conditions things degrade and which ones don't. Bioplastics again, there was some years, there is still hope that a lot of plastics become bioplastics, in other words, from natural sources, basically from plants. At the moment, as I hope you do, but I have said that, I think you should know that plastics on the whole of petroleum, they're hydrocarbons. The plastics we use generally are hydrocarbons. In other words, they use oil and gas. Very, very valuable resources. The aim is to try and sort of increase the amount of plastics we get from natural things like plants and reduce the ones we get from petroleum. It hasn't really happened to a significant level, but it is on an increase. Still, the amount of bioplastics is only a fraction of the total amount of plastics that we use. But hopefully for years to come, we'll be able to make plastics from trees or plants, etc. There are lots of references here. I'll put here for you if you want to do more. Perhaps this year, or perhaps in future, if you want to do projects in recycling, a lot of people are interested in doing that sort of thing, especially when they get to the final year. The references are there. I think that's all I want to say about recycling. We go there. All I need to have is an appreciation of that. Any questions on recycling in general? Okay, it is on my BU. So, a lot of it I've taken from other resources, from other references, and are there. Okay. Right. Let's talk a little bit about semiconductors. Do we know what semiconductors are? No, don't tell me they're semiconductors. So, can you think of typical materials, semiconductor materials? Germanium, yeah. Oh, sorry. Okay. Well, the most famous one is silicon. The most famous one is silicon. Now, do you remember from your chemistry or from your science, school science? Do you remember the electronic structure of an atom? The center of the nucleus of an atom, and you've got electrons around it, yes? What sort, how many electrons, what was the maximum number of electrons you can have in the outer shell of an atom? Hey, thank you. Hey. But they don't all have a full outer shell, do they? What is the distinction between metals and non-metals? when it comes to considering the number of electrons in the atom. Can you remember? No, look, can I? Generally speaking, no exception, but generally speaking, metals have between, in the atmosphere, have between 1 to 3 electrons in the atmosphere. They have 1, 2, or 3. Right? Non-metals have 5, 6, and 7 electrons. Certain elements like argon, for example, has a very full outer shell, which is 8 electrons. But the rest of them, as I said, non-metals have 5, 6, and 7 electrons in the outer shell. Metals have 1, 2, or 3 electrons in the outer shell. And the distinction between metals and non-metals is that the outer shell electrons in metals sit in what we call the conduction band. They form an electron cloud that causes conduction, that allow, facilitate conduction, both electrical and deconductive. But here at the moment we are talking about, in this case we're talking about, the concern with electrical conduction. Generally speaking, the electrons in an element, they can be either in the conduction band or the valence band. Valence band is the band or the energy that contribute to the bonding. Conduction bands are those electrons that can conduct electricity, or those electrons that we use to call free electrons. Okay. Now, there is a group of elements that have 4 electrons in outer shell, in their outer shell. They sit somewhere in between. They're not full conductors, they're not full insulators. One such material is silicon. Germanium is another one. Then there are compounds that have that. We call this group of materials semiconductors. Okay. Another way of visualizing this is perhaps a an effective way of visualizing these properties is what we call a band model. I said some electrons are valence electrons. Valence electrons are the ones that are good bonding. Some electrons are in the conduction band, so they can facilitate conduction. If the energy from here to here is almost continuous, in other words, if there is no gap between them, then these you get full conduction, easy conduction. In a metal, there is no gap between the between the valence band and the conduction band. In insulators, on the other hand, the conduction band is at a much higher energy level than the valence band. So in other words, these electrons cannot do conduction. So these generally are insulated. No conduction cannot happen. There is no electrical conduction. Semiconductors are somewhere in between. This way the materials can be classified into conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. Generally speaking, when the energy gap is less than about 2 electron volts, then the electrons can jump this barrier and actually facilitate conduction. If it is more than that, they can't. Silicon, for example, silicon has an electron gap of about just under 1 electron volt. Okay. It is like you are on one side of the river, and this is the river. In order to conduct electricity, the electrons have to be able to jump this gap. If the gap is small enough, they can jump it. If it's not, they can't. Now, I said electrons, if they can be persuaded to jump this gap, then you get conduction. That persuasion or persuading the electrons to jump is known as exciting. If you excite the electrons, in other words, energize them, give them energy, then they can jump. One way of doing it is by heating them. Generally speaking, I've shown this only a little bit smaller than this. In reality, this is a lot smaller than this. The energy gap is a lot smaller than this. Materials. As I said, materials like silicon and germanium have got a small enough energy band for electrons to be excited to be able to jump the gap. There is an energy level which is known as the Fermi level, and this is a level below and above which 50% of electrons, energy of electrons, exist. In other words, 50% of electrons have got an energy less than the Fermi level, and 50% more than that. It doesn't mean anything to you at the moment, but when we go to talk about p-n junctions, etc., this is a good way of good tool to describe the effect. Think of the Fermi level, this EF, Fermi level, as basically the midpoint, minimum energy that the electron has to get in order to jump the band, the gap. The Fermi level is named after an Italian scientist. This is called Enrico Fermi. It was sort of earlier this century, one of the most important scientists of recent years. A lot of these semiconductor and these electronic devices are all the discovery and development to him, Fermi. Hence, in his honor, I call that Fermi level. for Fermi level audit is that of 50% level. Okay, so don't worry about Fermi, they just touch it the 50% level. Okay, now, as I said, certain materials like silicon, certain materials like silicon are semiconductors because they have a relatively speaking narrow energy. When they are not, if you look at something like silicon, the electrons are generally in the valence band. In other words, they do not do any conduction. They don't travel, they don't move, there's no conduction. If you come and excite them, so to speak, then you can make one jump, the gap, into the conduction. When that happens, you get conduction. Right? But in order to do that, you have to excite it. One way of doing it in silicon is heating. But the amount of conduction is tiny, tiny compared to a real conductor, compared to a metal. These type of semiconductors are known as intrinsic semiconductors. If somehow you manage to excite one electron to go from here to here, then you have an electron, i.e., as I said, you get a vehicle for electric conduction. But when that happens, an electron hole is left here. An electron has a negative charge. If an electron leaves from an area, because a negative bit has gone, what is left behind is a positive bit, which we call an electron hole, or just a hole. Electron is negative. A hole or electron hole is therefore positive. You can think of these electron holes just like electrons, except that they are positive. In other words, they are charges. Electrons are negative charges, holes are positive charges. If you manage to move holes to conduct electricity, the same as if you manage to move electrons to conduct electricity. Okay. Remember this. Now let's look at how we can increase the effect. And here, if you forgot any, I've shown the structure of a silicon. A lump of silicon. If you remember, silicon has, as I said, has four electrons in its outer shell and forms bonding with other silicon using a covalent bond. In the covalent bond, if you remember, all the electrons are busy because they are busy holding the atoms together. They are the valence band. That's why there is no conduction. The only way you can cause conduction is by, as I said, exciting one of them and persuading to leave the valence band and go to the conduction band. And as I said, that is very difficult and the effect is very, very small. Really, the effect of the proper or the useful development of semiconductors happened when they were able to increase this effect. They increase this effect by what is known as doping. Imagine silicon, as I said, has four electrons in its outer shell. And all the electrons are engaged in forming the valence bond, inner loose bonding. If you put a few, only tiny, tiny amount, one or two of impurity and impurity atom in the silicon. For example, if you put one atom of phosphorus among lots of silicon, a phosphorus atom has five electrons in its outer shell. Five. Silicon, remember, has four. How many electrons? I asked you this before, and you remembered it. How many electrons do you need in the outer shell to form a complete shell? Max, eight. Thank you, eight. So if you add one atom with an extra electron, not phosphorus, as five, one more than four. If you add a phosphorus atom to a lump of silicon, in effect, you have one electron spare. You can think of it as that. Because to form a covalent band with silicon, phosphorus only needs four, it's got five. So it has one spare. That electron, that extra electron, is the electron that can facilitate in that semiconductor more conduction. Similarly, if you add an element with only three electrons to silicon, just one or two atoms to a lump of silicon, with three electrons instead of four, you have one electron less than what you need for bonding. You have one electron hole, you have one hole because it's three instead of four. That hole, as I said before, is like an electron. That hole has got a charge, and if it moves, it conducts electricity. Materials like aluminium have three electrons in there. In this way, if you add tiny amounts of aluminium to silicon, you have increased the ability to conduct, the same as you did it with phosphorus. When you do this to semiconductors, you form what is known as the other one was intrinsic. When you sort of add, dope them, you form extrinsic semiconductors, which are a lot more conduct, a lot more useful than intrinsic one. There are two ways of doing that. Two ways of making extrinsic semiconductors, one by adding elements that have one electron more than four, in other words, five electrons, or elements with three electrons. Example of the phosphorus, arsenic, aluminium, etc. Each the difference of one electron. If you add the ones with five electrons, you have one extra electron. If you add ones with three electrons, you have one extra hole. In terms of charges, it's the same. One electron charge is exactly the same as one hole charge, except that one is negative, the other one is positive. When you do that, you increase, look at that, you increase the conductivity 10,000 times as compared to pure silicon, just by adding tiny bits. By tiny bits, I mean countable. One in perhaps a million million. One in million million, right? So tiny, tiny amounts of dopants. In practice, the semiconductors we use are all extrinsic. Generally, they are, the most common ones are silicon with aluminium or silicon with phosphorus. The ones in which we increase the number of electrons are called N type, N for negative. And the ones that are produced by adding things with less electrons, like aluminium, are called P type. So we have two types of, in reality, useful semiconductors. We have two types, N type and P type. Now, what are the uses of semiconductors? Can somebody tell me? Thank you. That's one very, very, very practical example. Any other example?
Transistors.
Absolutely, transistors. Transistors were diodes, transistors were really revolutionized a lot of things, like gadgets, amplifiers, radios, etc. Before transistors were invented, to have any amplification, you need what they call a tube. It was something like an electric bulb. You haven't seen it, you might see them in some antique shops. Has anybody heard of amplifiers with tubes? It's like a bulb, yeah. Like quite a lumpy bulb. So the smallest radio you could get, even any radio, was something about a box about this big, because it had to house these bulbs. And they were the only way that you could do these things. That now a transistor about the size of your hair does. And it's all to do with this NP type and N type semiconductors. All to do with tiny, tiny additions of aluminium or phosphorus or similar. I've been talking about silicon, as I said, which is a pure element. There are other semiconductor materials that are made by compounding things, compound elements, so two or three elements put together to form the equivalent of a semiconductor. Gallium arsenide, for example, is one of them. Depending on the uses, they have gallium arsenide, for example, would be used for night vision, cadmium, telluride was another one. So it's not just silicon, but silicon is the most common one. It's probably and the cheapest one. Okay. One example of, I'm glad you mentioned solar cells. One example of using semiconductors in solar cells, and I'll talk about it in a second. But before doing that, let's have a look at the effect of putting an N type and a P type together. Can you remember, this is what you do need to know. What is an N type and what's a P type? Semiconductor. All you need, you don't need to know the exact energy levels, etc. But to know that an N type is a semiconductor extrinsic semiconductor that has been doped with something, with an element with five antigen electrons, and a P type one that has been doped with an element with three antigen electrons. The effect is one adds extra electrons, the other one adds or contributes extra holes. And as I said, I'm summarizing. The effect of this small element is increasing the conductivity 10,000 times. So that's the significance of
Which one adds?
Sorry, I just realized they're standing here. Tights, you're asking.
Which ones? No, which tights as?
The one in the, remember this. Four electrons in the outer shell is what semiconductors have, right? Silicon, that's four. If you add a tight impurity like phosphorus has five electrons in outer shell. Four electrons of these five electrons get engaged in forming a covalent bond. What actually happens is this. Okay, you have lots of, this is silicon. No, you have lots of these silicon atoms, right? Lots and lots of them. If you introduce something like phosphorus with five electrons, right? From each atom, four of them go and form this. Covalent bond with silicon, right? One, two, three, four of them combine with this. This one is spare. Right. Because this is an electron. Electron is negative, yes? So this forms an N-type. Okay? Does that answer your question? This forms an N-type because it's an extra electron. If you, instead of that, you add aluminium has three. Okay, so one less than that. In other words, a hole is created. When a hole is created, a positive charge is created. So we say that is a P-type door. The other one is an N-type door. These are all explained to you, I think, quite simply.
Sorry, who got it?
Look, this is, for example, instead of phosphorus, I've used aluminium. You have these. You've got silicon atom, right? You've got silicon atom. You introduce something like antimony. Antimony has five electrons. You introduce an antimony atom here. Antimony, as I said, has five electrons in the atom. Four of them get busy with silicon, sort of made with silicon. One is left free, spare. Okay, sure. That goes for conductors. A P type is the same as I said, just the opposite. Boron, I said aluminium is one, boron is another one. Boron is like aluminium, has got three electrons, so does the same thing as aluminium does. And it contributes a hole. All right, this hole is just as effective as that electron because that's the charge. But what is interesting is when these two join up. But before they join up, let me just show you the effect of doping them, the effect of doping them with in this band model. This band, energy band model, is quite useful. Imagine, think of energy bands as the ability to move. The more energy something has, the more ability it has for moving. Alright. As I said, this the in an intrinsic silicon atom, in other words, one without a donor, one without impurity, there was an energy gap, and the Fermi level was right at the center. It's halfway between this and that. Halfway between that, this and that. But if you come and add an N-type dopant, I said what you're actually doing is adding a negative liquid. The net effect of this is move this Fermi level. That Fermi level, remember, is the bit that would facilitate the level that would facilitate contact. You move the Fermi level up to those conduction bands because you have added an energy with N. If you add P type, you have contributed a negative bit, the full circle is an electron, a hollow circle is a hole, electron hole, which is a charge. In both cases, the effect is you have got this Fermi level, a lot more achievable. Okay? In one case nearer the valence band, in the other case nearer the conduction band. In both cases you increase conduct ability to conduct, but in different ways. Okay, here I've summarized it so it should really be very easy to understand. Now let's see what happens if I what happens if you join an N-type to a P-type? Here you have a P-type semiconductor, and here you have an N-type semiconductor, right? The P-type has excess of holes, in other words, excess of positive charges. N-type happens as an excess of electrons, i.e. negative charge. If you join them together, come and put them side by side, what happens? Right at the junction where they join, the negative bits, they cancel out the positive bits, and you end up with what we call a depleted zone. It's a sort of a neutral zone at the junction. That this p-n junction is in a state that we don't have any current across it, no voltage applied. When it's in that form, you have this depleted current. If you now put a charge across it, a voltage across it, what will happen? Put a battery. This is a positive one and this is negative. What will happen?
I guess that's all.
What happened? Look, they charged that if you positive light charges repel online charges attract. If you connect the positive side to the positive pole, then the charges move towards the junction. And the negative piece move towards the junction. That's right. The reverse is the other way around. The gap increases. So one way the gap decreases, the other way the gap. One way the gap decreases, the other way the gap increases. When the gap decreases, when the gap decreases, in other words, like narrowing that gap, the pulse, electricity pulse, is like that bridge over the river. The electricity flows. If you increase the gap, electricity doesn't flow. That means, for example, if you apply an AC current, what will happen? What is an AC? Do we know the difference between AC current and DC current? Oh, say. Yeah, what happens?
AC is like
What is the difference between AC current AC and DC current? Thank you. AC is like that, as you said, whereas DC is constant. The difference between AC and DC in practice is this. In an AC current, the current changes from positive to negative per every cycle. Positive, negative, and so on. The effect on, what is the effect on PN junction? The effect on PN junction is when it is positive, when it is one way, but depending on how you connect it, when it's one way, current passes, when it's the other way, it doesn't pass. It means the current will only go one way. In other words, a PN junction works like a one-way valve. Yes, a one-way valve. Changing an AC current to a DC current. Okay, that is another one of those things that in the old days it shows today. And the same way you can amplify, if you have a P, N, and then another P, if you put these in lots of things, you can form an amplifier. Well, in what way? Because in some ways, it will be, the amount of charge that is goes will be a lot more than what is causing it. That little voltage that you apply in one direction, that has said we change the PN junction into a one-way valve, if you design it properly, that can actually cause amplification. This curve basically is showing what I, just described. In one way you get flow of electricity, in the other way you don't, because the gap increases, the gap widens. Okay, that this is a very, very simplified, simplified model of what you said, the solar cell. A solar cell is essentially the PN junction. It's just that you have an N type and a P type. Generally speaking, you have a very thin N type over quite a thick P-type. And what happens is that the side that is sort of exposed to the sun, or electrons in the side that are exposed to the sun, are energized by the radiation from the sun. What happens if electrons are energized? That's right. They cause passage of electricity. And they generate voltage. Okay. In practice, you need lots and lots of these to have measurable voltages. This is a very, very simple example of the PN junction. Another important example is what they call a PNP or NPN junctions that are the sort of heart of transistors. But when these transistors were developed during for practical purposes, and actually making transistors was in the 50s. The amount of circuits that we could make was very, very small, per unit centimeter. The reason was that to make these, you need ultra impurity. You're talking about tiny amounts of impurity in silicon. I said one in 1,000 million, one in 1,000,000,000. That means everything S has to be perfect. The lattice has to be perfect. The impurity must be absolute perfect. There was no impurity. And they used to make, I don't know, out of when they initially started these, out of 100 or 1,000 semiconductors they made, they had to reject about 90%, 99% of it. Only 1 out of 100 was any good. The rest had to be rejected. That's why they were expensive. Now with sort of better technology, they're able to get much less wastage. With the advent of electron microscopy, purity level really high, and to make perfect lattices. Generally speaking, the first computer I had was in the 1980s. What a chip can do now is something like 1,000, 10,000 times more than what a chip could do then. Simply because they can make more of these junctions, more of these PN, NP, N junctions, etc. in a small area. These PN junctions, they are also the heart of circuit because they are switches. In the form that I said, they on off switches, and that is how computers basically work, by switching on and off using these junctions. Any questions on semiconductors? What you need to know, I said, you don't need to know all the different types of semiconductors. You need to have an understanding of the basic structure of semiconductors, the basic operation, the difference between semiconductors and insulators on the one hand, and conductors on the other, the effect of doping them, what n types are like, what p types are like, and what happens when we join them together. That's all you need to know. Okay. Any questions? Is anything wrong? Yeah? I finished the syllabus. You need to do a revision. And from next week, we have 2 more sessions left, yes? Two more. No, I think two more sessions.
Yes.
Two more timetable sessions left, and you need the two sessions for revision.
Okay.
No mister.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
I think all my friends are saying that, like.